everybody.
Hello.
Welcome to Healing Journeys Today. I am Teresa Houghteling, and if you've been watching the guest speaker for the month of July, then you know that this is my husband, Patrick, but if not...
I am Patrick Houghteling.
If not, this is my husband, Patrick Houghteling. So hope you very, very much enjoyed his teachings during the month of July. I know that you enjoyed doing them.
I always enjoy when I have a passion, when you have a passion to get something out, mm-hmm. you know, when God gives you a message to just get something out because you know somebody else is being affected by the same thing, you know, just
gives you
a passion to get it out.
So let me first start by saying welcome everybody that's already joining us on online. My apologies for not being with you live last Tuesday, but we were moving. So this last week has been a whirlwind. You notice that we have a temporary backdrop set up here and the house is finally coming together, but y'all don't need to know about that. But for all of you that prayed for us in the move and for grace to move, thank you so much. We love the new house. We love the area that we're in. So our thanks to all of you for your prayers.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. Much needed. And we're very thankful for them.
Awesome. So for those of you who may not have ever joined one of our teachings or one of my teachings, if you have questions, I do try to leave some time at the end for questions and prayer. So it's going to be a little bit harder tonight because he's here with me and he usually watches the feed and feeds questions and testimonies and prayers and that sort of thing. So maybe save your questions until we're getting to the end and that way your question is down at the end of the feed, but we'll do our best to kind of watch and keep track of those. If you do ask a question and we don't get to it tonight, please send it to info@fullyknownministries.com. And every Wednesday we do a live Q&A on our Fully Known Ministries YouTube channel and Facebook page. And that is at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. And it's live. And we answer questions that are sent to the email info@fullyknownministries.com. So please be sure to do that and join us tomorrow. And just a reminder, next week is the Healing is Here conference in Karis at Karis Bible College in Woodland Park, Colorado. So we will not be having live teachings next week because they'll just...
None of the HJT,
yeah,
right?
None of the HJT will be... teachers will be teaching next week because they'll be at the Healing is Here conference and you'll get to see them there. And we'd just be overlapping with teaching and man, it's live streamed. Be sure to go on there, take part, watch those sessions. It's going to be incredible. And I wish I could be there, but it's just too close to this move for me to get turned around and successfully get me there. So tonight I asked Patrick to join me. If you'll remember last time I was with you, we were talking about Christianese phrases. And the one that we spent 2 weeks on was how to cast your cares. You know, when somebody says to you, well, just cast your care on him. You know, if you don't know what that means and you don't know how to do it, that can be really, really frustrating. That's great. I know the word says that. I know it tells me to do it. I know that if he tells me to do it, I can do it, but I still don't know how to do it. So we're kind of tackling a few.
Do they know what we mean by Christianese? Is it Christianese to say Christianese?
Yeah.
Christianese is something, which I'm sure everybody already knows, is that when the person is standing up there behind the pulpit or teaching or you're watching a teaching live, Zoom, whatever else, YouTube, and they say a cliche or they say something that it's just something. And sometimes if you approach them with it and you say, well, what did you mean by walking in the spirit? What did you mean by casting your care? What did you mean by this or walking in the flesh, everything else? And sometimes that people say it so much that they really don't know.
Right.
You know, it's like, right. Well, it just says it. It means to walk in the spirit. You're supposed to walk in the spirit. Oh, and you just nod your head like you understand it. You know, it's like, oh, okay. Yeah, I get it. Yeah. So that's what,
yeah.
I don't like Christianese. And I think she mentioned this last week or something. It's like, if she said something, or I do it sometimes in my teachings, it's like, if you speak something that's Christianese mm-hmm. and it's like, oh, you need to explain that. I mean, that's the whole thing about discipling, mm-hmm. you know, is like break it down. That's how Jesus discipled his guys. they're walking along the road, that somebody throws a question at him. He says, and he finds a bunch of rocks and he says, okay, guys, take a seat on a rock. This is a good teachable moment. And he talks to them. Mm-hmm. He spills it out and he disciples them, mm-hmm. you know, so that's yep. what we try to get rid of, the Christianese.
When I started teaching, when we started Fulling in Ministries back in 2019, and I was just starting to cut my teeth on teaching, and every week Patrick would be like, well, what does that mean? Well, what does that mean? And I'm like, you know what it means. And he says, well, I might know what it means, but somebody else might not know what it means. And you know, so that's really why I decided to start tackling some of these Christianese things. So tonight we are going to talk about seeking him. So if somebody says, well, I have this issue and, you know, I'm not sure how to handle it. And somebody says, well, just seek him. Seek him first.
Just seek the Lord on it.
Just seek the Lord on. Well, that's great. But what in the world does that mean? And how do I do it? And this actually came from an email that we got in one of our What to Do Wednesday sessions, an email that said, how do I seek God? How do I seek his presence? I hear people say, seek God's presence, but I get confused because God is living in me. Why seek him since he's in me? And how do I do it? So the first issue we want to tackle there is the fact that he is with you. He is always with you. Matthew 28:20 says that he is with you to the end of the age. And just a reminder, there are scriptures listed in the description. If I go through something too fast and you miss it, you're going to find the scriptures in the description. And that Hebrews 13:5 says that he will never leave you or forsake you. But there are many times in the word where the word admonishes you to seek him. And I want to look at just two quick examples of that. In Psalm 27, verse 8, we are instructed to seek him. Yes, he is with us always and forever, never to leave us, never to forsake us, but we are instructed to seek him. You read it since you're there. Psalm 27:8.
Psalm 27:8. When you, this is New King James Version. When you said, seek my face, my heart said to you, your face, Lord, I will seek.
And that word face here in the Hebrew actually means presence. So the Lord is saying, seek my presence. He's That's telling good. His people to seek his presence. One more, Psalm 105. Psalm 105, verse 4.
Hey, this is pretty cool.
Electronics are neat, but I still like the Bible better.
No, I meant teaching with you.
Oh, okay. Oh, that's so sweet.
Psalm 105, verse 4. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face forevermore.
Seek his face always. There it is again. He is telling you to continually seek his presence. Why? Because there's benefits to seeking his presence. Let's look at a couple of those. And then we're actually going to get into some points of how to actually seek his face. But I want to show you in the word that God says it's important to seek him. So let's read something that we, a book that we always read almost every day, Amos. It's in the Old Testament.
I don't even know where to look for it. Amos.
Amos.
Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah.
Verse four. So these are, I'm going to give you four benefits to seeking him.
For thus says the Lord to the house of Israel, seek me and live.
Seeking his presence and live. Psalm 119. There's lots of Psalms.
Psalm
119.
Isn't that the longest book in the Bible?
I believe so.
Psalm 119, verse what?
Two.
Verse two. Longest chapter. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with the whole heart.
So you're blessed. Seek him and live. Seek him and be blessed. Blessing flows flows through you and to you as you seek him. His blessings are continually coming towards you, but seeking him is how you really tap into those.
This is one of my favorites. Psalm 34:10. Young lions lack and suffer hunger, but those who seek the Lord shall not lack any good thing.
Not any. Amen. not any, shall no, not nothing, lack any zero, good thing. Zilch, will not lack anything. As you seek him, all of these things will be added unto you. And we'll get to that verse later. And the last one here is Hebrews 11, verse 6.
And faith.
Oh, here, I'll just say it. Hebrews 11, verse 6 says, he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So mm-hmm. there's rewards, there's blessings, there's life, there is no lack. This is why you are admonished or why you're instructed to seek him, because in seeking him are all of these things, all of these benefits. Healing is in, when you seek him. So why? I guess the question is why? If he is, since he is in us, since he is with us forever, why do we have to seek him? And even though, yes, he is with us always, right? We're not always aware of that presence. It's in the seeking that we are aware. Think about those times, maybe in an awesome praise and worship session where you go in and you're feeling down. You feel like God is a million miles away, even though you know he's not. But as you begin to worship him, as you begin to seek him, do you know worship is actually a part of seeking him? As you worship him, you begin to experience that presence, not because he's any closer than he was when you were out in the parking lot yelling at your husband or your kids, or not because he's just as close then as he is in that moment in praise and worship when you are just connected with him. So it is in the seeking. So we seek him not for his benefit, but for our own, to make us more aware of that presence.
You know, two things come to mind. One is remember asking your dad. Teresa's father preached the word for 30, 40 years, amazing man of God, and asked him one time, so why do we do praise and worship? What happens? And why do you seem like you can mm-hmm. connect better? You know, or why do you see, when we go to seek the Lord, why do you praise and worship? He said, sometimes it's like plowing ground. You're the ground. Mm-hmm. There's soil. It's a good analogy right there from parable of the sower, that you're the ground and you have to take the plow and you have to break up that hard ground first and make it soft. And it's by you get yourself out of the way and you focus on the Lord mm-hmm. with the praise and worship. And then after, then you can, it's easier to receive and everything else. We don't necessarily always need that. You need praise and worship and need to worship him because he is worthy. But that praise and worship is good because it gets mm-hmm. ourselves out of the way. It changes our focus to seeking him.
Right.
And then the second thing that came to mind when we were talking about seeking him is that it always comes back to Middle East and Jordan. And when we first got over, when Teresa and I spent 2 years in the Middle East, that we got over there and everything else was removed. It seems like he was there in a greater capacity or a larger presence, but he really wasn't. Mm-hmm. It was just the fact that we were stripped of everything. And you might have heard us speak about this before, that our everything we had, everything we ever owned was sold and gone. It was just Teresa and I in a very conservative Islamic town in the middle of a desert, basically. And we're stripped of everything, family, friends, our possessions, safety sometimes, and everything else. But and it seems like when we're stripped of all that, that God was there and so much more in a greater presence. It seems like he was there more tangibly, mm-hmm. but he really wasn't.
Right.
It was just the fact that everything that occupied, that fought for, you know, everything back here in the States, you have so many things that's fighting for position over your relationship with the Lord, that when all those things are taken away and you don't have them anymore, then he's there. He wasn't there greater with us then than he is back here right now.
Right.
But he's still the same with us no matter where we are at mm-hmm. 2 a.m. in the morning mm-hmm. in the Middle East, here in the United States, wherever else. He's still the same, mm-hmm. same God. He's our God and he's still with us. He's mm-hmm. our Father, you know, but it's when all those other things were removed. So that's what I was thinking about that.
So we seek him again, not for him, but for us. Because he's, like Patrick said, he's the same. He's with you 100% all of the time. You know, when you're having a bad day, he's not with you 20%. You know, he is there 100%. He's not like off well, I'm just going to go over here for a while because they're in a really bad mood. You know, that's not the way he is. He's constantly there, but seeking him makes you more aware of his presence. And you have a promise in Jeremiah 29:13 that says, "And you shall seek me and you will find me when you search for me with your whole heart." This is a promise that if you seek him, he will be found by you. And this word seek in the Hebrew means to strive after. And that word heart is talking about your inner man. It's talking about your soul. It's talking about your mind, your will, and your emotions. So you seeking him involves every part of your soul, of your personality, of your emotions. You can seek him with all of those things. And he promises that you will find him. He will be found by you when you seek him.
There's so many verses that say, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. We have a good parable. The parable of the prodigal son, or like we like to call it the loving father, that as the son took one step toward the father started running toward the son, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. and you know, and just, I agree with you in listening to
I'm
all
glad.
That's a good thing. listening to all those verses is that there's a common theme. It's following, like Tozer says, I like to go back to what Tozer said, A.W. Tozer, he said, follow hard after God. Mm-hmm. It's that inward gaze of the soul. It's that following hard after God.
Mm-hmm. It's seeking, you know, in it, seeking God is really pursuing relationship with him. And you know, the capacity to know God is limitless. He is limitless. There isn't a time where you get to know him and you say, oh, I know all there is to know about him. I don't even know everything that I'll ever know about this guy. And we've only been married for 12 years, you know. And here's the thing, when we got married, when we entered into covenant relationship with each other and we moved in together and we established a home together, right? That's the moment
after we were married.
Yes. Well, I said established a covenant. So I guess I need to clarify covenant meaning we got married and then we got a house and moved in together. But anyway, the whole point of that, okay, is that is when we really started to get to know each other. This is, you know, we still have to pursue each other. We didn't just get married and then just maybe run into each other every now and
then
in the house, you know. This is the covenant was the beginning of seeking first this relationship above, except for God, but seeking this relationship above all other relationships, above relationship with our families, above relationships with our friends. This relationship comes first. Well, when you enter into covenant with God, when you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior, this is why Jesus died. John 17:3 says, this is eternal life, that you might know God and the one true God and his son whom he sent, Jesus Christ. He died on the cross so you could have intimate relationship with him, so you could seek him and find him. This is why Jesus came. This is the purpose of seeking, is building relationship with God.
Do you think Moses knew God?
Yes.
Moses knew God. Mm-hmm. But he actually used knowing God, the same guy that God would come down and speak with Moses in a tent, in a pillar of smoke, a pillar of fire, was with him on Mount Sinai and everything else. Moses used the fact that he knew God as an excuse to want to know him more.
Right.
God had already led the Israelites away from Egypt, mm-hmm. through the Red Sea,
yep.
and done all sorts of things. And yet, what did Moses say to God? Lord, that show me your glory. Mm-hmm. Show me your glory that I might know you more.
Right.
And that's the thing about knowing God, is that the more you know him, the more you seek him, the mm-hmm. more you want to get to know him.
Right.
The more he's just limitless.
And how does that work? I can give you a really good example of this, that, you know, the depth that you can know him is endless. You can know him as savior, provider, healer, comforter, give me some more, deliverer, rescuer, father,
you're doing good,
comforter, guide, counselor, Lord. You know, you can go on, and you can know him intimately in each of those ways. And just like you can know him intimately in each of those ways, you cannot know him also. And let me give you an example of that. When we moved over to Jordan in July of 2016, I had been healed for 2 years. And when we went over there, I went through a period of extreme grief over the things that we had left behind, mostly my 2 miniature dachshunds that were my babies that I had had for 11 and 12 years from the time that they were 8 weeks old. I went through a period of severe grief and oppression, and it was hard. And I tried to apply him as my savior, as my healer, as I had known him, right? I learned him as healer. I learned him as savior. I was walking in those benefits of, you know, knowing him as healer and savior. But that oppression really overcame me in that first year that we were there. And I didn't know how to handle it. I didn't know him as my deliverer. And when we came back after that first year, some of the symptoms had returned to my body. I had gone on back on low dose thyroid medication for a 6-month period while we were over there. I was doing the same things I was doing before we left, to trying to apply that revelation, reviewing that revelation that I had that led to receiving my healing. But we came back and I was like a whipped puppy. I mean, I was beat down. It was a rough first year over there. And I came back and we went straight into Summer Family Bible Conference, right? And the first praise and worship session, we started singing that Hezekiah Walker song, Every Praise. And we got to the part where it says, you're my savior, you're my healer, you're my deliverer. And God just shut my mouth. And I just heard it. I heard him say those words to me. You know me as savior. You know me as healer. He's saying, you know me intimately. You know who I am. You know what I think. You have experienced me. You have tasted and seen that I am good. And as healer and as savior, he says, but you don't know me as deliverer. And he was right. And because I didn't know him as deliverer, I didn't know what his word said about deliverance. I didn't know about what his word said about oppression and overcoming grief and all. I didn't know him as those things. So for the next 6 months, I spent studying. And we were back in the States actually for that 6 month because he had shoulder surgery and it was a long recovery process. And so we were back in the States for 6 months, but I learned who he was as my deliverer. And I went back to the Middle East in that second year. We did a lot better because I knew him.
What were you doing during that 6 months? You were seeking him with your whole heart.
That's right.
She was seeking him on that fact, on the fact that he is our deliverer.
Yeah.
She was seeking him with all her heart.
Yep. Yep. That's right. So this is what seeking him means. So let's get into the practical, because that's what we're starting to do here. Into the practical of how do you seek him? What does that look like? So I have, and Patrick might add a few more, but I actually have 6 things, and we're certainly not going to finish them tonight. Next week, we're not going to have a teaching because of healing is here. So I'll be back with you the following Tuesday and we'll finish up this teaching. It's really hot in here. Are you sweating? I'm sweating. Oh my gosh.
We spent 2 years studying Arabic while she cools off.
It's hot.
Yes, it is a little bit warm.
Wow.
But our ceiling fan makes terrible noise, so we're not going to turn that on.
It's really loud. Sorry.
So spending a couple years learning Arabic, there's a word, and I just learned this today reading about this. And the word for lesson is dars. So if I want to say the lesson, it's iddars or ildars. That means the lesson. And the word for, so I looked up the word seek in the Old Testament in the Strong's Concordance. You know, of course, they give you the Hebrew definition. And then also in the Old Testament, they often put the Arabic word and the Arabic meaning. Well, since that we've had time with Arabic, so I tend to drift toward the Arabic meaning in the Arabic. And so I read that and it was dars, da, ra, seen. Those are three letters, dars. Daras was a word. He studied, he learned. And that word, it means to, it's taken from the word to thresh wheat. It's what the word the Arabs used to thresh wheat also. And that's where it came from, to rub, to thresh wheat, to separate the chaff from the kernel, the grain, whatever else it does. Mm-hmm. It means to thresh wheat. And they would walk around and stomp on it or do whatever they would do. And that means, it means to walk to or to visit frequently. So that word, to seek God, the Arabic in it now, that's why I'm relating to the Arabic, and this really, not everybody probably can get that, but it means to visit frequently by walking. It means to go there a lot. And that what it means to seek, to go there a lot, to spend time. And that's what Teresa was doing when she was studying a very specific topic for those 6 months, that he was our deliverer. Mm-hmm. So she went there a lot. She tread that path. She went down that path every day, seeking him as deliverer.
Yep. Amen. Amen. Okay. So I'm going to give you a few pointers on how to, I think I cooled down a little bit. All right. So the first thing is to set your heart's affection on him. Okay. What does that mean? Right. Okay. Set your heart's affection on him. Matthew 6:33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all of these things will be added unto you. So the word seek means to earnestly covet. So what does earnest mean? It means to be sincere. It means to have an intense conviction. It means seriously, right? So you are seriously seeking him. This is a heart matter. The first thing in the how-to of seeking him is it is a heart matter. It's a desire that you have. It's a longing that you have. Psalm 63:1 says it perfectly. Let's read that. Psalm 63:1. I'm going to get there before you. Psalm 63:1 says, oh God, you are my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. This is a heart cry. And you know what? You will pursue what you truly desire. If you truly desire to seek God, you are going to seek God. You're going to find the time. You're going to make the time. You're going to make a place where there is no place. There are going to be no excuses, right? If you have a desire to do something, you're going to do it. If you want to make something a priority, you will make it a priority.
Can I comment on that?
Yes, you may. Please do.
Psalm 63, verse 1, is actually one of my favorites, where David says, early will I seek you. Mm-hmm. I always thought that meant like, okay, early in the morning. I always thought David says, oh my God, oh God, you are my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh long, that thirst that he longs for him in a dry and thirsty land. I always thought that meant David got up early, because we often read about Jesus getting up way before sunrise and going out and praying. Well, you can do it either way works, but early will I seek you. But it also means early, before, when a situation faces you or anything that you're seeking the Lord on, or if a problem comes your way or something, seek him first. Seek him early in the progression of things. Mm-hmm. Early will I seek you. He should be number one priority on everything. Mm-hmm. Early, he should be the first one you seek. His counsel stands above. Blessed is a man who Psalm chapter 1, who doesn't, basically he doesn't trust in man's counsel, but God's counsel, his wisdom, his knowledge, mm-hmm. his understanding, his will be priority everything, and seek that early, seek that first.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, not only early, but why not before anything even happens?
Right.
I mean, don't wait until you need to know him as healer to learn him as healer. Don't wait until you Amen. Need to know him as provider to start learning him as provider. And I did that way backwards over there. I needed to know him as deliverer before we went over in that first year. But, you know, sometimes sometimes that's the catalyst, right? Because I didn't know that I'd need to know him as deliverer at some point, you know, but when that first hint of trouble comes, when that first, you know, hint that something is happening, then like it says, early seek him, do it early.
But it behooves you. Don't wait until you're in the middle of a battle to learn a new weapon.
Yeah.
All right. Know your weapon. Be intimate with your weapon before you go into battle.
Right.
All right. All right. Important point. Write that down. Important point. Don't learn where the safety and the trigger is before you are when you're in the middle of a battle on a new weapon. Make sure you know where it is before you go into the battle.
Yes.
So
what he said.
Yes.
Okay, so the first point is to set your affection on him, that it truly is a heart desire to know him. And here's the thing. I think some people want to know him, but they don't have any desire. They don't have any desire to read the word. They don't have any desire to pray. And I can say that because even in my walk, there are weeks where it'll be really hard for me to open up the word. It'll be hard for me to, you know, to study, maybe not so much as much now, but as you just got to do it, you know, and as you do it, as you seek him, as you get to know him, you're going to want to know him more. And that heart's desire will come. That is because you know why? Because on the inside, your spirit is longing for communion and fellowship with the Father. So inside, even though you don't feel it on the outside, your inside is longing for him. It is thirsting for him in that dry and weary land where there is no water. Your spirit man is longing for him. And if you will just line up your thinking with that and just sit down and do it, sit down and let's get into the next point, because that kind of leads into that, is to fix your mind on him. Okay. Fix your mind on him. You know, Jeremiah 29:13 again says, if you seek him, you will find him if you seek him with your whole heart. And part of that word seek there is it refers to a state of mind. Okay. So seeking him is a state of mind. What does that mean? It means that it is a choice. Seeking him is a choice. You have to make the decision to do it. It's a mindset. It's getting that dogged determination. It's saying, I am going to seek him, and setting your mind to it.
This morning, I was meditating on a few different verses about this. And I was thinking about when a few years back, working in the Middle East, not being in ministry, but working in the Middle East as a private security contractor, when you spin up for training, I was thinking about training and seeking the Lord, and you set your mind. Mm-hmm.
Did you lose your train of thought?
Yeah, I lose my train of thought. But what I was saying is that I work for a company that shall remain nameless, but they offered, they were probably one of the top companies in the world at that time doing that thing. And so their training was number one. So I sought out the best training. I sought out what's best for me. Mm-hmm. I sought with all my heart. No, I don't want Joe Smith's budget training 101. No, I was going to Iraq and Afghanistan to take care and protect dignitaries and political officers. So I wanted the best training I could get. So I sought out the best that there was mm-hmm. to do that. Right. And it's the same thing that we have to seek out the best. And I think that's where I was going with it. The fact is seek out God, seek out because he is what's best for mm-hmm. you.
Yeah.
That in it, Bible says in Deuteronomy, where is that I've set before you life or death. Choose life that you may live. Choose me. It's Bible says, he says in Deuteronomy, he says, cling to me. He says, cling to me, for in me you have life. So I'm going to choose the best thing that there is. Yeah. So I'm going to seek him out, and I'm not going to seek out anything else that I know is not good for me.
Right.
Or that's subpar or, or below average or something else. Mm-hmm. I'm going to seek him and him only, because I know in him is my very life itself, is seeking him.
Right.
So.
So setting your mind on him.
Yeah.
Right. And Hebrews 11:6 again says, and believing that he is a rewarder of them who diligently seek him. And that word diligently seek is the Greek word means to search out or to crave. It's constant in an effort to accomplish something, to be persistent, a dogged determination. In other words, you aren't going to let anything, you aren't going to let anything stand in your way of seeking him. Back to Psalm 63:1 again, that says, early will I seek him. The definition of early will I seek you implies diligence. It implies an earnestness, again, a sincerity, an intense desire, a longing. So Colossians 3, let's read that one.
I got it right here.
Okay.
You probably already got it.
I'm
Colossians 3, 2.
Colossians 3, verses 1 and 2.
1 and 2. Colossians 3, 1 and 2. If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth.
So you are raised with Christ because you are daughters and sons of the Most High God. So he says, seek those things first. Seek the things, the heavenly things, not the earthly things. Setting your mind on the things that are above. Seeking him first. Getting rid of distractions. Getting yourself a mindset of I am going to seek him requires removing distractions.
Preach it.
Okay. I like to call them the weapons of mass distraction.
That's
what I like to call them. WOMD, weapons of mass distraction. And this goes back to the parable of the seed and the sower. Matthew 13:22. It talks about those, that seed that was sown among the thorns, and the thorns grow up and they choke the word. And it's the cares of this world. And you know, and the deceitfulness of riches, you know what? Those distractions are cares of the world. And we learned what to do with casting your care, right? And all of you should know what that means and how to do it now, how to cast your care. But we have to set aside those distractions. You know why? Because the enemy is going to throw this at you and throw that at you and throw this at you. And it could be your to-do list, right? This was my biggest distraction, is this to-do list. I would set all of these things that had to be done. And Lord, if I get all of these things done today, then I'll give you some time. Well, you know what? Seeking him means that you seek him first, that he is at the top of the list. And if you are an extremely busy person, again, it goes back to that point number one, setting your affection on him, that you will make time. You will find time. You know, maybe it's for a half hour after the kids finally lay down, you know, for bed at night, or you get a half hour in the morning before the house wakes up. And y'all know what we're talking about there.
People said, well, I can't find time to do this. I can't set aside time to get alone with God or everything else. You know what? If your water heater broke, or let's say for instance, you're a handyman and you can do things around the house. All right. Or handy person. If your water heater broke, you sure would find enough time. You would find 8 hours. Somehow you would carve 8 hours out of your day to change the water heater.
Mm-hmm.
Right. If you have place a priority on something, you can do that.
Yeah.
You can make time. You know, it just, no matter what you choose to do, if you give God your schedule every day, give up and give him your schedule.
That's right.
Seek him early in your day. Early will I seek you about my schedule. When I get up in the morning, Lord, what do you want me to do today? Is there mm-hmm. anything priority that I need to do today? Aside mm-hmm. from standard work, whatever else you need to do, family time, everything else. If there's something priority, then have God set your schedule.
Yep.
Carve out time for that. Okay, from this hour and a half, I'm going to study Word. For this half hour, I'll do this a lot of times that if there's certain things I pray for, and I have a list, I go down in certain scriptures that we pray over partners and supporters and everybody else. And I will say, okay, from 5:30 to 6 o'clock in the morning, or sometimes from 5 to 5:30 in the morning, I'm going to pray this mm-hmm. prayer. All right. And sometimes, you know what? My flesh don't always feel like it.
Yep.
You know, my flesh don't always feel like sitting down and reading or everything else, but dang it, flesh, you're going to listen to me.
That's right. Right.
My flesh, and I will make it do it. And I'll sit down and do it. Mm-hmm. And so anyways, this one.
And you will find that if you will discipline yourself to do that, if you'll sit down and you'll say, nope, I know, flesh, that you don't want to do this, but we are going to do this and we're going to sit down and read. That's one way that you walk in the spirit and not in the flesh. And eventually your flesh is going to start listening to what you're saying. And you are going to start seeing changes, because your flesh is going to go, wow, they're really serious. I need to take their word seriously. And you'll start to see changes happen. This is a perfect place, spending time in prayer, spending time in the word. That is a perfect place to start exercising your spirit man over your flesh. But now we're getting into spirit and flesh.
Yeah.
So I think we're gonna stop with these two points here. And then I've got four more that I'll go over with you next week. But those are the first two. Okay. Setting your affection on him, that it is a heart, it is a heart's desire that leads you to want to seek him. And then removing those distractions, getting your mind focused on him, getting your mind set on him. And sometimes, guys, that's the biggest battle, mm-hmm. is getting your thoughts wrangled in, you know, getting your, and just creating that space, creating that time where you can seek him. And next week, in 2 weeks, we're going to get into the rest of these. I'm just going to give them to you real quick because I know y'all want them. Number three is going to be seek him through prayer. Number four is going to be seek him in the quiet. Number five, I've got three hold up, and I say number five.
Number five
is seek him in the word, and number six is to seek him with others. And we'll go over those in detail the next time we're together. But I wanted to see if any of y'all have any questions or prayer requests. So now is a good time to put those in. I was trying to watch. I don't think there were questions yet,
but I'm gonna, late in the beginning.
Nope, this is just hellos. I do see that Judy is online. Judy Feeney is online, and we're going to pray for her husband, Pat, tonight. He was diagnosed with cancer. So we are going to believe with him for healing in his body. I'm just going through here. I asked everybody to put the questions and prayer requests at the end. So everybody listened.
Normally, this is what I would be doing, is feeding her the questions.
I know. Rachel says, yes, I need some biceps on my spirit man. That's funny. It is exercising your spirit man. Okay, so here is one. Patricia Calvin needs healing in her whole body. Well, that's like nothing for him. So as always, everybody, as we pray, I I hope that you will focus your attention on the one that we're praying for here and stand in agreement as we pray. So we just pray for Patricia right now. Father, whatever it is that is going on in her body, we just speak healing in her body from the top of her head to the tip of her toes. I speak to those blood issues. I tell her blood to be purified like the water is filtered through a water filter, that her blood is being purified even in this moment, Lord, and that she's going to start to see improvement quickly. And we thank you for supernaturally fast healing in her body. Prayer for Valdo, agreement in prayer for healing from cervical instability. I don't know what that is, but it doesn't belong to you. So Father, we speak to that. I almost said something. We pray for that spine, Lord, and whatever is causing that instability, I pray, Lord, that you just shore it up, that it is shored up, that it is strong, and that it is stable in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Prayer request for Jeanette. And then I'm going to pray for Judy and Pat. Neuro autoimmune disorder, autonomic nervous system disorder, connective tissue disorder, mast cell disorder causing allergic reactions. Father, right now we just speak to Jeanette's immune system. I speak the wisdom of God into her immune system. Immune system, I tell you right now that you know what is bad and you know what is good and you function accordingly. If it is bad, you attack it. If it is good, you support the life and the health in her body. I thank you, Lord, that right now that switch is just shut off. It is just flipped to the off position and her immune system functions normally in Jesus' name. Prayer for Angela against nerve pain. Lord, we just speak to that pain and we tell it to go in Jesus' name. Whatever is pinching that nerve that's causing that pain, whatever is causing it to be narrowed, I command it to be healed in Jesus' name. And right now, Father, we just pray for Pat. We pray for Pat and that bad report that he got. I speak to that cancer in his body and I tell it to die in Jesus' name. It cannot stay. I thank you, Lord, that even right now it is shriveling up into nothing and it turns to dust and leaves his body in Jesus' name. I thank you that at that next meeting, the report is good, that the labs are better, Lord God. I thank you that our words have power. I thank you that our words, we have authority to use the name of Jesus, that the power comes from you, God, but you have given us the authority. And we use our authority right now and we speak healing over Pat's body in Jesus' name and we command it to be healed. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Prayer for Tina. Protection for COVID. There's some symptoms with her daughter and her mom and Tina as well. So, Father, we just speak to that COVID. Your name is above every name. You say at your name, every knee shall bow. And we command COVID to bow right now to the name of Jesus and that those symptoms leave their bodies right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. If you see any of these and you want to pray, you just let me know.
Okay. I was just thinking, y'all spend some time in Psalm 91. It doesn't matter what variant out there. It doesn't matter if it's Delta, Echo, hotel, Lima variant, I don't care what variant it is, that the name of Jesus is above everything. Okay. Psalm 91 says in three different places that no plague shall come near my dwelling, mm-hmm. that I shall not fear the terror by night, nor the arrow that flies by day. I will not fear the pestilence that stalks in darkness. I will not fear in the name of Jesus any virus, any pestilence, any plague, any disease that stalks in darkness. I will not fear this. In the name of Jesus, that he covers you with his feathers and under his wings you take refuge. His truth is your shield and your buckler. And it says in just three different places in Psalms 91 that this plague shall not come to you. And you state and declare that we are death to this virus.
Amen.
If that virus touches us, it's death. Mm-hmm. You speak that. You claim that over your family. You claim that over yourself. All right, get intimate with Psalm 91. Spend some time on it. Every day, pray this and make it personal.
That's right.
All right, I thank you, Lord, that I dwell in the secret place of the Most High. I abide under the shadow of the Almighty, that I say of you, Lord, that you are my God. You are my refuge in whom I trust.
Amen.
All right, you make this stuff personal, all right, and you use your words and you speak that out loud, all right, and speak it.
Hallelujah. We pray for Shaf Khan, for her son, Aaron, healing from ASD. What ASD is? Is that a neurological? It doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter
that I don't know what it is. We speak to that ASD and we command it to be gone in the name of Jesus and all of the symptoms to go with it. For Drew, 812-002, healing in the eyes. Father, we just speak clear vision that they see near and they see far without any defect in their vision at all. We'll pray for Wayne Myers, who's on a ventilator, again, because of COVID. Lord, I thank you. I thank you that right now that there is healing flowing through Wayne's Amen. Body, that pretty soon he's going to be demanding to have that ventilator pulled out, that his lungs are healed and a whole and restored in Jesus' name. Prayer for Christina. Need prayers over my body. No diagnosis. God knows my need. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, I just thank you that you have already provided healing for Christina and that you said in Deuteronomy 28:61 that those things that are named and those things that are not named are covered under the blood of Jesus. And even though we don't know what it is, you know what it is. And we just speak healing into her body in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Okay, here's a comment from Sarah. I feel unwell, scared it's cancer in my lungs or in my brain. I feel oppressed by death. Okay, Sarah, fear and oppression are all coming down to what you are thinking on. If you are thinking that these symptoms are this or these symptoms are that, if you're dwelling on the what ifs, then you are going to experience fear and oppression. So what you need to do is concentrate and focus on and set your mind on what the word says about you. You are worried about things that haven't even happened yet. And you know what? When we do that, that just leaves a wide open door for the enemy to come in. So you begin to stand on his word, stand against those symptoms, speak against those symptoms, and they will go in Jesus' name. Prayer for Diana. Hallelujah. Prayer for Diana. And then we're going to end here. Where did we just go here?
You know that speaking about fear, Psalm 118, verse 17. When fear gets on you, that people actually fear is a bondage. Mm-hmm. All right. Through fear of death. All right. There, Hebrews 2, chapter 2, verse 15. I think it's verse 15. Says, who through fear of death were subject to bondage all their lifetime, or fear is a bondage that will hold you. And I don't know if you've ever been in bondage or been oppressed like that, but it's terrible. But when that starts to come upon you, when you get that attack on you, Psalm 118:17 says, you know the enemy's attacking you with that fear, and you state this, you declare this, you start speaking this. Your words have power. The power of death and life is in our tongue. It's not the power of death and life is in our thought. The power of life is in our tongue.
That's right.
It means we speak out the words. We speak it. When you speak God's word, it physically changes the atmosphere around you. All right. It is powerful. It is powerful when you speak God's word. Anyways, verse 17, I shall not die, but live and declare the works of the Lord. You know, and the other one is that one that comes to mind. Do not gloat over me, my enemy. When I fall, I shall arise. When I sit in darkness, the Lord will be my light. You start speaking. You have to know your weapon. You have to start. That's why it's important to know God's word. When that fear of death comes on you, I shall not die, but live and declare the works of the Lord. And do not gloat over me, my enemy. When I fall, I shall arise.
I love that one. That's Micah 7:8.
Oh.
When I fall, I will arise.
Y'all don't take this. In the end times, when there's going to be people that see the devil and there's going to pit, they're going to say, is this the man? Is this the thing that deceived the nations?
Mm-hmm.
They're going to be astounded. I forget where that's in the word. But in times, they're going to see the devil and they're going to say, is this the thing that deceived us? Is this it? It's deception. Mm-hmm. Don't let him deceive you.
That's right.
You've been given authority and power. You are in Christ.
That's right.
You are seated in Christ in heavenly places above all principality and power. And God has given you, Luke 10, verse 19 says, behold, I give you authority to trample on serpents and scorpions, to crush, to walk on, to grind your heel, to crush the necks of your enemies.
That's right.
God has given you power and authority. So speak these things out. Don't settle for it. Don't put up with it or anything else. But you have to force yourself to speak, because sometimes you don't want to speak. Mm-hmm. It's just bottled up inside and you just start brooding. You start feel oppressed, because I know I've been there. But you have to force yourself to speak God's word and get mad, get angry at it.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Well, that's some good preaching there at the end. I do want to pray for Diana just real quick here for breast cancer to shrink and leave. We speak to that breast cancer. We tell it to die in the name of Jesus. And I believe you're going to start to see that thing shrinking even by the time that you wake up tomorrow. And Raquel or Rachel Jones, we are standing with you and believing with you that your neck and back are healed and that you will be running very soon with your toddler. So do you want to close this out?
Sure.
Okay. Awesome.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for this precious time with your precious sheep, Father, your church, your sons and your daughters, Father. We bless those that joined us tonight, Father. We just bless them and speak prosperity, health, strength over their lives, Father. And thank you, Lord, that you've given them wisdom and revelation and that they know the wisdom and revelation that you've given them. We thank you for the honor and privilege of just speaking about you, Father, and just we thank you for who you are, Father. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. So just a reminder, if you had questions and we missed them, please send them to info@fullyknownministries.com and be sure to join us tomorrow on our Fully Known Ministries Facebook page or YouTube channel for our live Q&A session at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. And otherwise, we will see you in 2 weeks. Love you guys.